hallelujah. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise, hallelujah. And bless the Lord this morning, hallelujah, for all that he has done and all that he will do for you. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
You are here, moving in this place. I worship you.
I worship you.
You are here. Oh, you are here. a miracle worker. He's an awesome miracle worker. Hallelujah. He's the light in our darkness this morning. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Well, he is the Lord, and he reigns on high. He is the Lord. We'll be right back.
greet somebody, maybe with a bow if you don't want to shake hand, and a smile, and a God bless you. And this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us all rejoice and be glad in it. It's quite warm on the inside. We have had lots of showers last week, and I trust that they were not just rain showers, but some showers of blessing actually came your way, of which you can give glory and praise and thanks to Almighty God. I'd be asking for about two testimonies. Somebody probably have a burning testimony. You really want to share your testimony. I want you at this time to come forward, take the microphone, and share your testimony of the goodness of God. Hallelujah.
The enemy cometh to kill, to steal, and to destroy. But I thank God this morning for his blessed assurance that he is come that I may have life and I may have it more abundantly. And this morning, I just want to agree with the psalmist David that says, oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercies endureth forever. And it is the mercies of God why I'm standing here this morning. It is the mercies of God why Shiloh is sitting in her seat this morning. This morning, we could have been on the hospital bed. This morning, we could have been in the graveyard, but we are still here this morning, and we are not here to be passive, but we are still here to give God all the praise and all the honor that he deserves. By now, most of you would have known that we were in an accident about a month ago, and Shiloh and I came out without a scratch on us. And we just want to give God all the glory and all the praise that he deserves. The enemy troubled our waters, but we are still here this morning. And I just want to thank those of you who would have prayed for us, those of you who would have sent a word of encouragement. God is a miracle-working God. You know, when we got in the accident, it was as if there was another presence in the car. We were there, and normally I'm very coward. I would be screaming, oh God, or something like that. But I was there, and there was just a peace in the car. Shiloh did not make a fuss. I kept asking her, Shiloh, you okay? And she said, yes. And when we got home, she said to me, Mommy, you know, if it wasn't for God, we would not have been here this today. And I just want to thank God this morning for Jesus. God is indeed a miracle-working God. And so my aim is to continue living for God.
He's a way maker. He's a promise keeper this morning. He is a light in the darkness. You know, I came back from Trinidad and I finished my exams and I did well. But to apply to the Ministry of Health, I was not getting anywhere. You know, there were mornings when I woke up and I would just be frustrated. I would say, God, you took me to Trinidad for 5 years, no job. What is this? You know, my friends in Trinidad, St. Lucia, had already started their internship and I became worried. I said, God, this is a setback. I began to work with my sister-in-law and it was a great experience. But I thank God for Jesus this morning. When your name is on it, it's on it. When your name is on it, it's on it. And I want to tell somebody this morning that God is going to part a rugged river for you this morning. Just trust and wait with him. And on Thursday, I got a call and they said, Dr. Caesar, you want to start at the hospital on Monday? And before I could answer, tears just came to my eyes. I said, when you wait on God. Because the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. Satan, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. And I thank God for making a way for me this morning. He's opened up in a new way. And I just want to thank God. I'm so excited. And I just want to give God praise. You know, when people people achieve, we ought to celebrate with them. And I ask you to celebrate with me this morning. And I want to encourage you, if you're finished with college, trust God, He is going to provide a job for you. If you're just finished CXT and you're not happy with your results, don't worry. Go to college still and God will make a way for you. Continue to trust Him. Continue to serve Him with all of your heart. There is nothing out there in the world for you, young people. Trust God and live according to His precepts and you would see. You would see. Hallelujah. You would see what God will do in your life. God bless you. I stand here this morning as a living testimony. You know, faithful God. God has been faithful and He will always remain faithful. Many of you didn't see me at church last week, but I was sick. When I tell you sick, you see dengue fever? It's no joke. It's no joke. From the crown of my head to the very sole of my feet was just pain. I could hardly see to the back of my eyes. There was a pain there. I couldn't open my eyes for days on end. The headaches, the loss of appetite. But this morning, because of my balm in Gilead, because of my way maker, because of my miracle worker, I'm still here. I'm still here. I've been battered, bruised and torn, but I'm still here. Some days my life was filled with fear. Oh Lord, and I cried.
I cry. Oh, I cry and I cry. I cry and I cry. I cry and I cry. But your love surround me. Your love embrace me. I'm still here, Lord. I'm still here.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. I can identify myself with that song. I'm still here. Hallelujah. The enemy's tried. And he tried, but I am still here. And I thank God this morning for his goodness. And I thank him for his grace. And I thank him for his love towards me. Because God has been indeed good to me. He has been merciful to me. And I love the Lord with all my heart. And all that is within me, I love my God. Hallelujah. You know, when you are living for the Lord, the enemy will throw all darts of you. All darts from the inside and from the outside. But my loved ones this morning, be of good courage because Jesus has overcome. Hallelujah. 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 The songwriter said, no mountain he won't climb up. No walls he won't kick down. No lies he won't. He's our God. He's my friend. And he's my rock. You know, last week, Saturday, the enemy tries. In the night, I was so sick. And then I get a text message from the minister who are going to minister the word. And she said, you have to prepare, but it's because it seems like I cannot make it. And I said, Satan, you're a liar. In the mighty name of Jesus. And I know the Lord. And I know in whom I believe. And this week, I had the dengue. But God is still in control. I remember Wednesday, my granddaughter came home from school and I was so upset. But she came home and she had this headache and she began to vomit. And I said, God, you are still in control. You are still in control because you are our healer. And my brothers and my sister, just trust in the Lord. Trust in the Lord. Temptation will come. Persecution will come, but trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not unto your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge God and he shall direct your path. I love you all. God bless you.
I turn to Jesus. Sometimes I get discouraged and a tear comes to my eyes. Sometimes life doesn't seem fair and I can't understand why. Sometimes I want to give up when things aren't going right. Sometimes it feels like a waste of time, not really worth the fight. Those times are when I turn to Jesus. He listens to my prayers, and suddenly the way is easier, the problem not so hard to bear. He doesn't promise earthly treasures if we follow in his way. He does promise to fulfill our needs each and every day. So let me walk a little closer, Lord. I know you love me so. When problems are overwhelming, I have a friend who knows.
Wonderful. God bless you, Shiloh. And for all of you who may be going through some stuff, I want to give you an encouragement this morning that you can still trust God even though you cannot see him. Somebody used the word traces. If you can't trace him, you can still trust him. And those testimonies really encouraged me today, and I hope they encourage you as well. We are in God's house and we are in God's presence. And the Bible says that where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. And I trust that you will just open up yourself and allow Jesus to do for you what you cannot do for yourself. I am reading from the book of Genesis chapter 17. Verse 1 to verse 6. The book of Genesis, chapter 17, verses 1 through 6. We are reading from the King James Version. And when Abraham was 90 years old, and 9, the Lord appeared to Abram and said unto him, I am the Almighty God. Walk before me and be thou perfect, and I will make my covenant between me and thee, and will multiply thee exceedingly. And Abram fell on his face, and God talked with him, saying, as for me, behold, my covenant is with thee, and thou shalt be a father of many nations. Neither shall thy name any more be called Abram, but thy name shall be called Abraham, for a father of many nations have I made thee. And I will make thee exceeding fruitful, and will multiply, and will make nations of thee, and kings shall come out of thee. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, this is the day that you have made. Our hearts rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you that you have kept us amidst all the challenges and what the devil would have thrown at us. Some would have knocked us down, but didn't knock us out because we are here today. And Lord, we come to give you thanks. We pray even now that your Spirit would move mightily among us, that you will calm every fear, that you would uproot every seed that the enemy has sown, that it will be destroyed by the power of the mighty name of Jesus. We ask that all who have entered these doors today would hear you speaking to them. And as they commit themselves to you, you will do for them what they cannot do for themselves. Lord, I stand here as your servant. I pray, Father God, that you'd use me as a channel through which your blessing can flow to my listening audience, to my dear brothers and sisters. I pray, Father God, that you would minister to each need as your word is being spoken. You would reveal yourself afresh. Grant me the anointing, an utterance from above, anointing that would break yoke and set captive free, anointing that would bring glory to your name. Lord, I pray that you would be glorified in everything. None of me, but all of you. Indeed, Lord, I must decrease while you increase. Be thou exalted, we pray, in this place. Receive all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. I pray against any hindrance that the enemy would want to put here right now in the name of Jesus. We expel it with the blood of Jesus, and we take authority over everything that is unlikely. And we pray that your blessing indeed would flow in Jesus' mighty name. And God's people say, praise God. I want to speak to you today about newness. As maturing people, we like new things. We like to have new things. And although there are some persons who are afraid of change, and they are afraid of new methods and new experiences, but generally, we like new things. We like to have new things. And maybe if I ask how many of you can do well with some new things, I believe I will see many hands. And the things would be diverse as to what the things, the new things would be. For some of you, some of the things that you have, they're old and worn out. And you wish you could replace them. But you can't replace them, so you just have to be content with the old thing that you have. And so there is a longing in each of us for some kind of newness. Something new that we want. New clothes, new shoes, new job, new vehicle, new possessions, new everything. But brothers and sisters, new does not always mean better. New doesn't always mean better. You can have something new, but it doesn't mean that it was better, or it's better than what you had before. And some persons get tricked because they feel that new means better. I remember having bought a new shoe and put it on, and as I was walking to church, I feel a cool breeze in my foot. And when I looked, the shoe was so dry rotten that the whole thing was torn. A new shoe. I think that some people probably have experiences that they can share with new things. And that's why I say new doesn't always mean better. However, God is a God of newness. And his newness is always betterment. When God gives you something new, it's better than the old. When God gives you something new, it's far better than what you had before. That's the kind of God that we have. He is a God of newness. In fact, in the first book of the Bible, we are told that God created. In the beginning, God created. Now, I want you to note that God's creation was not a duplicate. There was nothing to duplicate, but God came up with his own invention. He came up with his own stuff and his own invention. A fictitious story is being told that one man challenged God. And he said, God, look at man. Look at, you know, there are so much faults. God, I can make a better man than you. And God said, okay, go ahead. I accept the challenge. And so he stooped down and he started gathering dirt. And God called out and said, hey, hold on, wait a while. Just wait a while. Why don't you use your own dirt? You get it? Whatever is in existence came from God. Man can create things in this life, maybe new things, but the material would have come from God. But in the beginning, there was nothing. And so God decided that he was going to do something new. And he created. His invention was original. God's provision of newness did not stop at creation. God is still doing new things. When God made you, and God, for those of you who have experienced the new birth, God didn't stop there. He is still doing new things. In fact, in the book of Lamentation, a book in which you will hear the writer lamenting, mourning, and grieving, yet we are told in Lamentations chapter 3, verse 22 and verse 23, that his mercies and compassions are new every day. Great is his faithfulness. Can somebody praise the Lord? So our God is a God of newness. There are many new things that you would have gotten from God that you wonder sometimes, is there anything else new that is to be had? And I said yes, because we are told that every day, every morning, we have new mercies, new compassion. That's the kind of God that we serve. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 17, as we move from the Old Testament to the New Testament, there again we see God operating in newness. The Apostle Paul says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away, and behold, certain things have become new. Behold, all things have become new. So it tells me that our God is a God of newness. When you come to Jesus, he gives you new birth. He gives you new hope. He gives you a new home. He gives you new destiny. He gives you new family. He gives you so many new things. But it doesn't stop there. He's a God of newness. But you know, sometimes we get our new things and they become old and obsolete and insufficient, and we need a renewal. For those of you in the field of education, you would know that sometimes your methods are outdated and you have to take what they call a refresher course, so that you can be on the cutting edge. You have to update yourself, man. Some of you have some nice gadget, but over time those gadgets get old and obsolete, and you have to update. You have to plug them in. You have to connect to the internet so that you can update your equipment. Some of us can do well with an updating, but we can't plug in ourselves to the internet. We have to plug in ourselves into real power, the power of the Holy Ghost, so that we can get an update. I say we need an update. Because if the device is not updated, it can't function, it go malfunction. Some of us malfunctioning because we need an update. We need some kind of newness from God. The scriptures tell us about three newness that we need to encounter these times. These are real challenging times, you know. We encounter all kinds of issues and challenge, and they are new. Therefore, newness must meet newness. When we encounter newness that create problems and challenges for us, we have to also respond with newness. And God has put in place some newness for us so that we can encounter and overcome the challenges that we face. And there are three of them that I wish to point out today. Firstly, God wants to give you a new vision. Secondly, God wants to give you new vigor. And thirdly, God wants to give you a new version of yourself. New vision, new vigor, and a new version of self. This is what we see when we read the book of Genesis and we look at the account and the conversation between God and Abraham. Abraham was a man of faith, and he had his challenges. More so, his serious challenges, as he noticed that his life was ebbing away. His strength was ebbing away. He noticed that he had gotten old, 99 years of age. And he remained childless. He had much possessions. He was a rich man. He had many servants and lots of possession, but he had not a single seed. He was childless. And even though God would have told him before, when he was still much younger and his wife was younger, God would have said to him, Abraham, you are going to be the father of many nations. But Abraham looked and he saw that his life was ebbing away. And he looked at his circumstance and he said, this is impossible now. I am 99 years of age. And we know that at 99 years of age, we don't expect a man to produce. And even worse, we don't expect a woman who is around 90 years, his wife was about 90, to become pregnant and have a child. So the circumstances, the evidence was there to say that all is over. You have no hope. But sometimes God allows us to go to the very end and edge of the cliff before he puts in his appearance. And so this was the case with Abraham and his wife. Past childbearing age. Hopelessness. No one to inherit his possession and to carry on his legacy. In fact, Abraham even told God how he felt. He went, when God appeared to him and greeted him, God said, Abraham said, well, what is that, God? I don't have any children. And he said, God, but I have a backup plan, you know. My servant, who is a good man, Eliezer, I'm going to pass on my possession to him. I'm going to leave my inheritance to him. But God said, that's not what I told you. Abraham's vision was skewed. And so God had to give Abraham a new vision. And hence, God had to come in contact with Abraham and talk to Abraham so that whatever scale would be on his eye would be removed and he can have a fresh vision and he can see differently. God wants us to see differently. So God affirmed Abraham of the promise that his descendants would be like the dust under his feet and like the stars in the sky And these are two important analogies that God used in order to give Abraham a new vision. When we examine the reality of dust and stars, dust seems to be unimportant. You just walk on it. It's just dust. That's not so important. But God was saying, when you think that's not so important, it's even what is not important can turn out to your benefit. The stars, they are out of reach. They are so far. But God is saying to him, even what you think is out of reach is reachable. For with me, all things are possible. So dust and stars become very significant in getting Abraham to catch a new vision. God wanted Abraham to see whatever is dry and insignificant can turn to your benefit. Whatever seemed to be out of reach can also turn to great blessings for him. I ask today, is there anything in your life that seems worthless, useless, and insignificant? God is saying to somebody today that the little you now have, the damaged possession, the mad and battered life that you possess can be turned around so that you have great blessing and prosperity. God is saying he can do that for you. He can turn things around for you. Abraham seemed to have been experiencing dryness and things were out of his reach. But God, in his providence, restored him a vision. And we are told that Abraham believed God. At 99 years of age and his wife 90. And God said, you're going to have a child. And Abraham believed God. How many of us would believe God would say, this can't be God. I wonder who talking me. I wonder who trying to fool me there. Oh, you think I stupid? But we are told that Abraham, he believed God. And that was faith. God credited that to Abraham as faith. And so I say to you, the same God of Abraham is our God today. And what he did for Abraham, he can do for you. In fact, he wants to do for you. He's ready to do for you, to give you a fresh vision. I don't know where you are. I don't know what your circumstances are. When you look and you see and you feel so discouraged and down, and you feel it, it's impossible. I say to you that our God is able. So we pray today that God would help you to see differently, better and brighter, because he's still a miracle working God. Can somebody say amen? So pray for a new vision today. Pray for a new vision. When you have a new vision, it means that you are seeing a job in your state of joblessness. When you have a new vision, it means that you are seeing that you are debt free, even though the bills are piling up. When you have a new vision, you are seeing that you have a healthy and strong body and mind, even though the medical report says that you are badly sick. When you have a new vision, you see yourself walking with God and seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, even though you would have failed and messed up. But right now, God is saying, I have a new vision. direction for you. I want you to see things differently because I have a journey to take you on. Our God is specialist in change and in newness. So I say to each of you, take heart. God does not only give us new vision so that we can see things differently and have a life of hope, but God also gives us new vigor. Vigor speaks of renewed strength. It's not the kind of strength that you will get from whatever this world has to offer. It's not the strength that you will get from Guinness. You don't drink Guinness and say you get vigor. Not that kind of vigor there, man. Or Vitamalt. But we're talking about something that is all-encompassing. For the scripture says in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31, they that wait upon the Lord shall do what? Shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. That's the kind of vigor that I'm talking about. Hallelujah. Abraham was 100 years old, and his wife was Sarah was about 90. Yet God told them, you're going to have a child. This seemed so impossible for two old people. Two old people that would say, all they're doing is waiting on the Lord. No. They better go and make sure they get a go pass by Mills or some other funeral home and see that they get a nice casket. But God restored their hope. And God says, you're going to have a child. The whole thing looked laughable. In fact, Sarah did laugh when she heard the angel, the man of God, telling Abraham that your wife is going to be, next year about this time, your wife is going to become pregnant and she's going to have a child. And Sarah was listening and Sarah laughed. He said, that is really laughable. And indeed, if you don't have a new vision to see things differently, then you are going to look at the present circumstances. You are going to look at the evidence and you are going to say, this is what science says and this is what I believe. But God wants you to believe beyond science. So God was working on them. He had given them new vision and God was going to give them new vigor. New potency so that a child could be God. I don't believe in those days they have anything named Viagra. My dad, I don't think so. I really don't think they had those things in those days. So poor Abraham and Sarah. The whole thing looked laughable, you know. The man, maybe couldn't do nothing, but and she done dead, that womb, they done dead. And no Viagra to help them, nothing. So what we're going to depend on? So you understand what is happening here? I mean, we could in our modern day, you get all kinds of things that could help you. Some people they go overseas, they say they go to the medical center, they can have a child, and they will do whatever they do, and they come back and they even get triplets. But that was not available in that time, in those days. So the only thing that they could depend on was a miracle from Almighty God. That God would awake that deadness man and that God would bring life. That is vigor. God knows how to give you vigor. I see the men laughing. You know what I'm talking about, man. Our God is a miracle working God. And Many times we see him defying science. God is not limited to science. My Jesus walked on water. Who you can't walk on water? So God gave Abraham and Sarah new vision and now new vigor. Two old people going to have a child. God was able to do that. This old lady at 90 became pregnant. And she was able to carry a child for 9 months. A 90-year-old woman. Oh, what a mighty God we serve. When you see a 90-year-old woman, when daddy say a something, a growth he had it, he better go by the doctor, go cut out that. But it was indeed a child. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Glory to God. It happened. And that old woman was able to bring forth that child, 90 years of age. It happened. A miracle working God. Brothers and sisters, we need renewed strength to face the kinds of challenges that we are encountering these days. Sickness and death. Maybe in our family, loss and grief, worries, stress and disappointment. You need vigor for that, you know. Yes. You need strength when the days are dreary. You need strength in every area of life. We need strength. Somebody needs strength today. I don't know what you're going through. Somebody wants to give up, but you need strength. God can give you vigor. New vigor, new strength to pray. Some of you have been praying a long time and you ain't seeing nothing and you seem as though you're ready to give up. But don't forget, my Jesus, he prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane and he prayed until his sweat became like great drops of blood. He was drained at the end of that praying. At the end of that ordeal, he was drained. But guess what? We are told that the Heavenly Father dispatched an angel from heaven. And he came in that Garden of Gethsemane and strengthened Jesus. Oh, some of us, we do need our Heavenly Father to dispatch his angel and send so that you can be strengthened to meet the challenges and the task that you are encountering. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When we get a new vision and a new vigor, brothers and sisters, we cannot go on being the same person. Seeing things differently, receiving new strength, it means that you a change. You have changed. And hence, the Lord would go further and he would give you a new version. A new version of self. A new version here doesn't just speak of just being a new person. But that speaks of being like Christ. When you become like Christ, if any man be in Christ. The focus here is in Christ. When you are in Christ, you become like Christ. You're not the old person anymore. Old things are passed away. You are a brand new person. You might not even feel like you knew, but I say that feelings can change. God's word doesn't change. And if he says that you are new, it means that you are new. God wants each of us to say with confidence every day when we get up, God, we want to say, he wants us to say, my today is better than my yesterday.
He wants us to speak like that in the present, regardless to what you are encountering, regardless to what you see. He wants you to say with confidence, my today is better than my yesterday. He wants you to face the future square with strength and say that my tomorrow will be better than my today. That's how God wants you to live. After God gave Abraham and his wife a new vision, a new vigor, he gave them a new version of himself. In fact, God even changed the name. God said to Abraham, he said, hey, Abraham, his name was Abraham. You see, you don't know Abraham, Abraham. God said, Abraham, you know Abraham. You are a new person now. You are now Abraham. God changed his name. Oh, some people, they have some kind of names, you know. And some people may even be call you funny names. And names are significant. So God was saying, you are now, you have a new label now because you're a new person. You're not Abraham no more. Your wife not Sarai anymore. You are Abraham because you are the father of many nations. And your wife not Sarai, Rastarai. You are now Sarah. So God made the change. God says, I already give you new vision. I give you new vigor. And now you get a new version. Oh, hallelujah. That's newness. Can somebody praise God? From childlessness to a father of many nations. Some of you have a deep longing, and it seems to be very frustrating when you see time fleeing from you. And it seems not to be getting anywhere. But God wants to give you today a new vision. You can see things differently. New vigor. So you have strength to do what needs to be done each day of your life. And a new version of self. Being like Christ. So that you can look at your life with contentment. And feel a sense of satisfaction. All you need to do is to believe God. Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. And so God wants to do that for you today. I ask, are you ready for this newness? Are you ready for the new vision? Are you ready for new vigor? And are you ready for the new version? Stand with me and let us pray. And whatever you need, believe God today.
God, we praise and we worship you. Thank you, God, because you have brought us into your presence. Thank you, God, because your manservant has spoken your word. Thank you, God, because you have given us the understanding to understand. Oh, God, thank you for Abraham and the recreatedness that happened in his life. God, you said in your word, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature, all things are passed away, and behold, all things have become new. Thank you for what Jesus Christ did in spite of what Adam and Eve did. And thank you for salvation. And thank you for new life, that new recreated life. Oh God, I thank you because our pastor spoke to the Father about Abraham. But God, as we look into our own lives today, oh God, search us today. God, you have given many of us vision. But oh God, we are not starting the mission. And God, even though you give us a vision, there is the mission field. And God, so many of us here that you have called, give us a vision to do mission. But there are so many constraints. And oh God, we come against them today in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I pray God today that every one of us here in this building that you have given a vision for mission. God, that you're going to open our eyes as you opened the eyes of Abraham. Oh God, In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Oh God, your anointing. God, you ask the question. In your word, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believe? I pray, God, that your Holy Ghost would empower every one of us who are believers here today. And God, that the scales will be removed from our eyes in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Thank you again, God, for the word that you have sent to us. Thank you again, God, to help us to receive it, oh God, and to implement them in our lives today. Oh God, we praise you. We worship and we exalt you. Oh God, if there's anybody here who is not saved, I pray, God, that you would bring them to the foot of the cross today. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. They will not leave this place unsaved today. Oh God, trouble their hearts today. Let them realize they need to be saved. Oh God, as someone said yesterday, you don't have to know the whole Bible to be saved. But John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God, we thank you, we praise and we worship you. Oh God, settle down upon your people. Let us examine ourselves, oh God, and do that is right before we leave here. In Jesus' name, hallelujah.
Praise God with your head still bowed. It's closed. If there's anyone here you do not know Jesus as your Savior and Lord, I invite you to say the sinner's prayer. Sinner's prayer doesn't have to be a long prayer. One man went to the temple and all he said, Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner. And we are told that he went back to his home justified. So if you're here today and you haven't known Jesus as your Savior, I invite you to say this simple prayer. Say, Father in heaven, I have lost my way, but I thank you for Jesus, who is the way, the truth, and the life. He came and he died for my sins. And he rose again from the dead for my justification. Forgive me for all my sins. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Save me, I pray. As from this day,